This program is brought to you by the Stanford Humanities Center. For more information, please visit us at shc.stanford.edu.
Geography of the Post is an approach to studying the integration of the American West. And it's the idea of trying to recapture how half of a continent got settled and integrated into the rest of the country in such a short period of time. So this is the landing page for Geography of the Post, and what it's showing is every post office that existed between 1846 and 1902, about 14,000 offices. Geography of the Post is a way of actually mapping that, using the post as a kind of proxy for communities. A lot of communities were extremely ephemeral, impermanent. Post offices are actually a way of getting at that. So you can actually see a tremendous number of post offices opened, existed, and then closed within the space of 1 year. And that gives this extremely fine-grained view into Western development that we just don't have using other sources.
In some cases, the post office is the only time where you might have one of these towns showing up in the historical record anywhere. And so for us to be able to see where these communities are at, when they go away, when they establish themselves, has been, I think, one of the big payoffs for the whole project.
I think it really stemmed from the fact that if we think about Western history, 19th century in particular, we don't actually know a lot about the geography of that history. So we talk about things like railroad construction, or we talk about things like mineral rushes, the gold rush for instance. But if you actually get down to it, it's a little bit murky as far as where people actually were in the West and how that changed over time. So I was trying to kind of conceptualize ways in which we could get at that.
I think the biggest challenge we had throughout most of the project was the amount of data. We were visualizing something around 14,000 post offices, which in the age of big data may not sound like much, but for the humanities, that's a good chunk of data. By the nature of being data in the humanities, it's rather complicated, it's kind of messy, sometimes it's incomplete. So Geography of the Post was an opportunity for us to engage in a research collaboration and also to explore some ways that visualization tools could be used for analyzing historical data.
When I'm talking about microfilms and we're kind of transcribing things, even when it's put into a database form, the scale of that is almost impossible for human readers to kind of comprehend. So what you can do with this tool is then kind of aggregate it, put it onto a map, and essentially make it legible to historians. It gives a different kind of spatial narrative rather than just a chronological one that we tend to tell in our writing.
I think the most impressive part of the project is there's a particular view called the status view. And within the status view, what we did was showed any one of the four statuses that a post office could have. So it could be closed, it could be opened, open and closed, or alive throughout that entire span of time, which is actually a fairly complicated thing to do. I'm still kind of astounded that we got it to work the way it does, and that it works as well as it does.
So if we move to a period from the late 1870s to the early 1880s, this is from 1878 to 1882. And what I'm going to do is just show you post offices that closed down during that period. So these are post offices that shut down in a 5-year span. And the orange ones are ones that were established prior to that time period. The red ones are actually post offices that were established and then shut down within that small 4 to 5 year period. So if we actually look at the actual lifespan of that post office, this is Sage Creek in Wyoming. You can see it actually only lasted for a single year. In 1869, the Transcontinental Railroad was completed, met in Promontory Point, Utah, and united the country together. And you can see that happening across space using post offices. But what's really interesting to me is that as it's being constructed, at the exact same time, you see a really dramatic boom in southwestern Montana of post offices. And this is due to a much smaller and lesser known mineral strike, but it's happening at the same time. And in traditional narratives of the West, those two things are completely separate, and one of them gets subsumed under the other. But if you put them onto a map, you realize they're actually happening at the same time and not that far away from each other.
Really, what impresses me is the way you can see the life cycle, like the life cycle of these areas come and go and then come again, and how you can witness the growth. Not all tech work is just sitting in a room and coding. A lot of it is, you know, what do you code? You know, how do you communicate these things to the outside world? And that takes a lot of breadth of knowledge, I think.
When Cameron and I think about the arguments that are embedded in the project, which is really in some ways about community and its rise and decline in the West, I think it becomes very apparent that that's happening as you interact with the project. And so I hope that when researchers come to it, they have a chance to sort of look at the data we've worked with and the ways that we've visualized it and either agree with our conclusions or perhaps find ways to challenge us, which can be a very fruitful thing for everybody involved.
What post office postal geography kind of allows us to do is distinguish between different kinds of community. And it's not that we didn't know that these communities existed before, but what this does is that it allows us to kind of track spatially across space and geography and over time where and when they existed. And then if you aggregate them out, it shows a regional picture that is very different from other regions of the United States.